threes in the first half. Good low ball in. Quick one to Colm O'Rourke from way out the field. Is it another equaliser? It is! A man from screen has done it once more. It's up to Tom Howard. Can Dublin avail of it? Charlie Redmond, well blocked down by O'Malley. If he never did anything else, he did well.
Thank you. A very, very warm welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the Burlington Hotel here in Dublin and the annual Bank of Ireland GAA All-Star Awards, the occasion when the best hurlers and footballers of the year are honoured. It's also, of course, a very important social occasion on the GAA calendar, because apart from those players who have won awards here tonight, there are many other well-known names and faces who have come here to enjoy this special event, to meet some old friends and perhaps to make some new ones as well. Well, of course, the main purpose of RTE's involvement here tonight is for the actual presentation of those awards. And for the footballers, that means the actual revealing of the winners a little bit later on, because, as I'm sure you know, the hurling team was announced yesterday. Well, this year, it's the turn of the footballers to be kept in suspense, well, maybe for just a little bit longer. But more about that later. But before we get to the presentation of the football awards, let's first perhaps remind ourselves of the year that's been in Gaelic football. It was a year when Donegal played some sparkling football during the closing stages of the National League. Mind you, it was difficult at that stage to imagine them losing their Ulster and All-Ireland crowns, but lose them they did to another big D from Ulster, the men from Derry.
1992 had belonged to Donegal, and the side's progress to the National League indicated an insatiable appetite for glory. In the final against Dublin, Noel Hegarty's equalising point kept ambition burning. There was to be no such reprieve a week later, as the Dubs zealously sought to atone for that 92 All-Ireland defeat. May 30th was a red-letter day, as Clare, then Munster champions, put their hard-earned title on the line against Cork. Biddy Early against Billy Morgan. A star was born that day, as Colin Corkery's final contribution came to an impressive 2 goals and 5 points. Same day, and the 1991 champions were back on the title trail in Newry, facing Derry. But scarcely can so few have done so little, as Derry romped to the easiest of Ulster wins. The league now just a distant memory, Donegal went about their opening provincial assignment in less than convincing style, having just 3 points to spare over Antrim, who hadn't won an Ulster championship match for 11 seasons. Harry Houdini played the game of his life at Croke Park for Mick O'Dwyer's Kildare. Martin Lynch literally ran the show, shattering gallant Wicklow in the process. Victory for the Lily Whites, the Lily Pond for the Garden County. Next day, the Dubs, who had beaten Wexford in their opening engagement, passed another test rather easily against Westmeath in Tullamore. With Donegal, Dublin, Cork, Meath and Kildare all still in the hunt, the scenario was quite familiar. Some even whispered the word Derry. In Ulster, it was shaping up to be the year of the draw. Armagh were at it again, drawing a second match in the series, this time through the timely intervention of John Toner, who got 8 of 13 points against Tyrone. Meath made a bright start against Laois to set up a mouth-watering meeting with Dublin in the semi-final. The annual movement of people in Munster means it's annual pilgrimage time. This year's gathering was in Killarney. Cork came, saw and conquered, in the process redeeming a barren 2-year spell. For the first time since 1957, Kerry had failed to reach a Munster final. In Connacht, Mayo, with Jack O'Shea giving directions, were expected to eclipse Sligo. They got there all right, but not with the ease that many had anticipated. Casement Park was the venue for the first Ulster semi-final, which saw Derry finally romp to an 8 points win. Joe Brolly came on as a sub and stamped an immediate imprint. July 4th, and Dublin and Meath were set for another contretemps. Memories of 91 and 4 outstanding games. Could it happen again?
Is it another equaliser? It is! The man from screen has done it once more. The saga continues in Croke Park. It's up to Tom Howard. Can Dublin avail of it? Charlie Redmond, well blocked down by O'Malley. If he never did anything else, He did well to get that one. And Jack Sheedy sends it over. And everybody is on their feet.
They were on their feet in Munster as well, where Tip were appearing in a first Munster final since 1944. But their bid for double honours floundered early, with the concession of 8 points inside the first 17 minutes. And a late goal sealed their fate. St. Tiernach's Park in Clonus seemed more in readiness for ploughing than playing. However, amid the synchronised sinking and aquaplaning, there were those who could walk on water. Over in the west, Roscommon led Mayo at one stage by 5 points, and then enter one Ray Dempsey to put the finish to a fine move.
Knockmore man drives it in! A goal from Mayo!
The Leinster final went largely as predicted, with the Dubs continuing to stifle Kildare ambition. The Metropolitans, in winning a 42nd title, were again down to 14 men with a quarter of an hour remaining. Running into stout challenges, kicking with accuracy. Mayo took a pasting in the first of the All-Ireland semi-finals as Connacht football was dealt a serious blow. Cork beat them by 20 points.